I've already had me some experience in the presence of the Lord today and just looking forward to what God has for us today. Thank you so much for coming out to worship with us. Before we get started, though, let me just remind you of a few things that are going on this week. And we got some things that are taking place today. Prayer in the sanctuary today at 5:30. Before we go there, let me just let all the youth and youth team know that they'd like to meet with you over here. If you're a youth or a youth team member, just immediately after the service, if you want to meet on this side over here, please keep that in mind. Tonight, we're going to do discipleship just a little bit different tonight. We're going to have our youth classes and our kids classes, but the men and the ladies are going to stay with me tonight. There's some things the Lord's laid on my heart that I want to share with you tonight. And also, we're going to have some discussion along those lines, some of the stuff that I'll be bringing out in the message today. So tonight, the discipleship will be all the ladies and the men will stay with me in here tonight, and I'll be facilitating that tonight. And we just see what the Lord has for us, and we just believe for that. Prayer meeting tomorrow at 5 o'clock. We're just believing and trusting for the Lord's will to be done. Never stop praying. Pray without ceasing. So remember that. And then our Wednesday night Bible study, digging in the Word, at 7 o'clock on Wednesday night. So I encourage you to come out for that. And then Saturday, this coming Saturday, the seniors will be serving at the soup kitchen at 9 o'clock. This Saturday is also Apple Festival, so it could be very packed. So make sure that if you signed up or you can help with that, that'll be taking place this Saturday morning at 9 o'clock. So don't forget about that. Next Sunday, the youth will be having a fundraiser after the service. Going to be having cake and pie auction and also having BLTs. So come out for that next Sunday night. And we look forward to a great time of fellowship. We always have a good time of fellowship with that. Sponsor the youth for Christian Music Day. This is the 26th of September. They're going to be having Christian Music Day at Carowinds. If you can help with this, $40 will provide admission to the park, the day of the festival, and the Christian music concert. So if you can help with that, see Mitzi or Stephanie, and they'll be able to give you more information about helping with that. Also, our Lats for Life fundraiser for the CPC is coming up October the 10th from 9 to 1. It's going to be held at Hoyles Grove North. If you'd like to be a part of our team, see Stephanie. She's leading the team for Daystar, the walk team, and she can give you more information about that. Also, just to let you know that we did move forward with trying to raise some funds to purchase the Dr. Chang's building for the CPC. We're looking for 1,000 people in the county, 1,000 people in the county that would do a one-time donation of $300. I've already got a few people that have committed that to me, and we just need to do this over the next 90 days. It's not anything that you have to come up with. If you'd like to help with this, it's not anything that you'd have to come up with right now. But if it's something that you'd like to help us with, to help us purchase this building debt-free, that's over the next 90 days. We've got to come up with 1,000 people that would be willing to help with $300, a one-time donation. If you're not able to do that, but you know someone that would be able to do that, would you please pass that information along and let them know what we're trying to do? This is a prime time for the agenda of abortion that's going on. If you've not seen the videos of Planned Parenthood and what's going on with, it's amazing to me that they don't call it a baby, but they'll call it a heart, a liver, kidneys, whatever parts that they're harvesting, but they won't call it a baby. It's absolutely amazing to me. And we're in this fight. 89.6% of ladies who are abortion-minded, who see that baby on an ultrasound or hear that heartbeat, change their mind about having an abortion. And that's what we're trying to do. For those of you who think, well, it ain't that big of a deal in Lincoln County, 99 reported abortions in 2013 in Lincoln County. 99. That's just what was reported in Lincoln County. That doesn't include people that have gone to Catawba County or Gaston County or Mecklenburg County, but in Gaston County. You think about it. You look across this room, say there's 100 people here today. What if everybody here were killed? Dead. I mean, we'd hit the news, folks. Amen. If something happened and tragically this building fell in and every one of us died, we'd make the news. But they don't want to talk about the number of innocent lives that are being murdered, for lack of better words. And so we're just trying to do our part here in Lincoln County to do what we need to do. So if you can help us with that, whether it be through the walk, whether it be through a one-time donation of helping us purchase this medical facility, or if you know of someone that you could let them know, hey, CPC is trying to do this, and you know they have a heart for life or pro-life, have a pro-life stance, and you can help pass that word along, we'd greatly, greatly appreciate it. If you want any more answers about any of the questions of that, let me know after service, and I can tell you more about that. So we got that going on for CPC. We're good? All right, so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let me give you a couple of requests that were given to me before we get to the list. Brother Scott's dad, Ed Bollinger, will be having a colonoscopy tomorrow. They found some things that concerned them. So remember, Ed, if you will, that God will touch him and minister him. Also, the new family that has been coming some, Doug and Sharon. Doug has had a severe attack of arthritis that took place this morning. He sent me a message, said he's watching live, but they're not going to be able to make it this morning. Hope they'll be here tonight. So remember him, if you will, as he's had this attack with some severe arthritis. Eva Mae Wilson, this is April's mom, right? Grandmother. Grandmother is in Baptist Hospital. So remember her, if you will, that God would touch her and minister her. Mitchell Strontz, 18% of his body had been burned. So please pray for him. Toby Decker is dealing with Adam Oliver syndrome. Carmen Santa Marie is attempted suicide. Mr. Freeman, one of Sister Sheila's clients, has had a stroke. His wife has just recently passed away also. So remember this family, if you will. Sister Debbie has some upcoming surgery coming. Terry McGinnis, thought they might have had a kidney yesterday. He was second in line for the kidney, and the person before him took received the kidney. There was a 20-year-old that passed away and was an organ donor, and it was an opportunity for Terry to receive the kidney yesterday, but the person on the list right before him took it. So Terry had to sit around from 12 till 6 o'clock last night without eating or drinking anything with the chance that he may get a kidney. But do continue to remember this situation, that God would open up a door for him and that it would work out for his glory. Frank Olszewski, continue to pray for him as he's battling cancer. Doctors are saying there's nothing they can do. Barbara Matheson's husband is dealing with Alzheimer's. And continue to remember Elizabeth Sherrill, David and Elizabeth Sherrill. Remember her. She's been dealing with some pain in her sinus region that's shooting pains up into her head. So remember her, if you will, that God will touch her and minister her. And we serve a great God. Amen. He's an on-time God. Amen. Amen. I tell you what, you're a good-looking crowd today. Amen. I mean, listen, if a duck can't quack in his own pond, what's the problem here? A bullfrog ought to be able to croak in his own pond. Amen. When I say croak, I don't mean die. I mean croak. Amen. You're a good-looking crowd today. Thank you for coming to the Lord's house. Let's stand up. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. Ask God to have his way. Listen, thank God for the miracle. Jordan's on the drums this morning. Amen. Amen. Could have been a whole different scenario. Just pray for his strength, for his leg that'll hold up through this worship service. I pray the Holy Ghost get in here and start moving that leg, get the Holy Ghost in. They start doing that number right there, boy. I'll be all right with you on it, Jordan. Amen. No more therapy. Just let the Holy Ghost take care of it. Amen. Pray the Holy Ghost be your physical therapist today. Praise God. God's good. Amen. Would you join with someone near you and let's pray together and just believe. Listen, I'm just going to say this in confidence, but I want us to bind together for families, for homes, for marriages, for finances and homes, that God will just move and minister. I'm not trying to call anybody's situations out, but I'm just believing that Lord's going to move and minister. Amen. We got some folks that are in some real need, and we're believing and trusting for the Lord's will to be done to those families, that God will just have his way. I just believe and trust that when we pray and agree together, that God will move and God will minister. Listen, God is faithful. Amen. Amen. So Michael, Kelly, and Kayla are heading on the missions trip to Honduras. So remember them if you will. Father, we love you. What a great God you are. You are faithful. God, I have sensed your presence this morning. I thank you, Father, for your presence, your grace, your mercy. The enemy would do everything he could to stop us from this moment right now, from being able to join together, God. He would try to divide. He would try to conquer. He would try to bring division within the body of Christ. But God, we bind together, not just physically, but symbolically and spiritually, we bind together in unity of heart and mind, God. We call upon your name together right now, God, believing and trusting for your will to be done. In every need of every quest, God, those that have been mentioned, even those that are unmentioned in this sanctuary today, Father, we just lift up situation to you right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we're believing for your divine will to be done. Father, I bless your name today. We give you glory and honor and praise, Jesus. You're such a good God. We glorify your holy name. We lift up families to you today, God. We have families that are dealing with financial situations. Lord, we pray that you would move according to your divine will and your purpose, God, that you would demonstrate your glory and your kingdom purposes in their lives, God. I pray, God, that you would meet every need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Father, we have marriages that are strained, God, is the best way I can put it, Lord. And I pray that you would strengthen husbands and wives and help husbands to love their wives as you love the church, and wives to submit unto the Lord unto their husbands as unto the Lord. And I pray, God, that you would move in their homes and minister to their children, God, and help us, Lord, to be effective for your kingdom work, God. I pray in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray for every need on our quest list, God. I pray for healing and divine intervention, Lord. God, that you would touch Ed Bollinger today. Touch Doug today, God. Minister healing to him, Lord God. I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord. I pray that you would touch Frank today and heal him by your mighty power, God. I pray that you touch April's grandmother, Lord, as she's in the Baptist hospital. Move in this situation, I pray in the name of Jesus. Touch Terry today, God. Lord, you do the surgery, Lord. I pray that you would perfect that kidney that's in him, Lord, that they're saying has no life. Speak life to that kidney, I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord. If it be your will that it goes through transplant, God, I pray that you would move in this situation and open the door that no man can shut, God. Make a way for him, I pray in the name of Jesus, Father. Bless your people today. Help us, Lamb of God, as we come together in this one place. Help us to come in one mind and one accord. We got the place down, God. Help us to come in one mind and one accord, God, that the glory of heaven might be ushered into this place, Lord, as we worship you and praise you and magnify you today, God. You're such a good God. We bless your holy name today. Touch our musicians, God. Anoint them and use them in a mighty way today, God, as they lead us into a place of worship. Our singers, God, our worship team, God, use them in a dynamic way. Give Kelsey great wisdom and understanding, God, to be able to handle this service that's before us today. Father, we surrender it to you. God, I pray a special blessing for Jordan today, God, that you would strengthen that knee, God. Bring divine healing to that knee, God. I pray, Lord, we said it in jest just a moment ago, but God, I was serious. Holy Ghost, have your way in every musician, God. Touch their hands, touch their feet, touch their legs, God. Touch our worship team. Touch us across this sanctuary, God. Help us to use our instruments today to magnify you and worship you. God, you gave us our hands, not just so we can grab things, but God, that we can clap our hands and worship you. God, you gave us our feet that we can dance in your presence. You gave us our mouth and our lungs. You gave us this breath, God. God, that we can surrender it back unto you and worship and praise, God. Help us to use our instruments of praise today to glorify you and to magnify you. Father, you are worthy of praise. You are worthy of glory. You are worthy of honor. And we just give it all to you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Come on, hug the neck of the one that you had their hand. Tell them you love them. It's good to see them in the Lord's house as we get started.
Jesus, oh, you're worthy, is the sound of your great name. Our hungry souls will receive grace at the sound of your great name. The fatherless, they find their rest at the sound of your great name. The sick are healed, and the dead are raised at the sound of your great name. Come on, sing his name.
Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are.
slain for us. He's Son of God and man. You are high and lifted up. Let all the world will praise your great name. Your great name in this place today. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Come on, sing it. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up, and all the world will praise your great name. Lift your voices to him this morning. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. All the world will praise your great name. We worship you in this place, Jesus. We thank you for who you are this morning, for what you've done for us, God. You have taken precious from the worthless and given us beauty for ashes, love for hate. You have chosen the weak things of the world to shame that which is strong, and the foolish things to shame the wise. You have taken the precious from the worthless and given us beauty for ashes, love for hate. You have chosen the weak things of the world to shame that which is strong, and the foolish things to shame the wise. So God, I look to you, and I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. From the worthless and given us beauty for ashes, love for hate. And you have chosen the weak things of the world to shame that which is strong, and the foolish things to shame the wise. So God, I look to you. You know just what precious from the worthless, and you've given us beauty for ashes, love for hate. And you have chosen the weak things of the world to shame that which is strong, and the foolish things to shame the wise. Honestly, that is not a part of the song at all, but I felt like God laid that on my heart this morning. Because we're singing in this song, God, I look to you, I look to you. And the part of this song that says you've taken the weak things of the world to shame that which is strong, and the foolish things to shame the wise. You know, in life, in ministry, in so many different things, we try to do it our way. And we can't. It won't work that way. So this morning, I'm declaring to him that I'm looking to him. I want him to show me what he wants me to do. I want him to show me what he sees, so that I could only walk in the way that he wants me to go. And I hope that's your prayer this morning too. Not only in just your personal life, but also in this ministry as a whole, because we're all a part of this ministry. So I'm going to sing that part again. I want you to really listen to those words and make that your prayer this morning. You have taken the precious from the worthless, and you've given us beauty for ashes, love for hate. And you have chosen the weak things of the world to shame that which is strong, and the foolish things to shame the wise. So God, I look to you, and I won't be overwhelmed. And God, I look to you, for you're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom, 'cause you know just what to do.
So good. Come on, give him praise in his house this morning. God, so good. What a great God we serve. What a great God we serve. Can we just join together in prayer one more time? Father, we love you. We thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity that you've given us to come into your house. Thank you, Father, for your grace and your mercy. Thank you, Lord, that we can look to you. You are our strength. You are our power, God. You are our wisdom. You're the grace and the mercy, God. Everything embodied within you is everything that we need, God. And we just surrender to you and we look to you. God, we look unto the hills from which comes our help. Our help comes from the Lord. God, we thank you today, God, that our substance is in you. Our sustenance is in you, God. Our provision is in you. Everything that we need, God, is in you. And Father, we just rest in you. We abide in you, God. We live in you. We move in you. I have our being in you, God. It's all about you, Jesus. Help us to make it about nothing else, God, but just you. And Father, we'll make much of you, Lord. We'll just worship you and praise you, God, and make much of you, Lord. I believe that you'll make much of us, God. But it all comes through your strength. It all comes through your grace, your mercy, God. Your power, God. We love you today. We give you the glory. We give you the honor and the praise for it. We ask it in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. If you would stand, if you're not already standing, for the reading of God's word. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're continuing with this series. As long as the Lord lays it on my heart, I'm going to continue to go with this In Christ Alone series. Because we got to figure out and understand that it is in him and him alone. But we're going to look at a different aspect of who Christ is to us and what he has done in our lives. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning with verse 18, we're going to read down through verse 30, I believe it is, 31. End of the chapter. I know it's several verses, but there's two particular verses that we're going to pay attention to, but this just brings it in context, if you will. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. If you have it, say amen. If you're looking at the screen, say amen. All right. If you're looking on your neighbor, say amen. All right. We want to make sure everybody's looking somewhere. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign and Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews a stumbling block and to the Greeks foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things that which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen the things which are not to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that as it is written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord. I want to focus on two verses out of that text. Verse 24, the Bible says, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God. And verse 30, but of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption. Today I want to specifically focus on the wisdom from God. What Christ is to us. The fact that we are in Christ, he is the light of God's wisdom to us. It is the wisdom from God. Father, help us today to understand the time and the season that we're living in. I pray, God, that we would have the spirit of the sons of Issachar. God, that we would know the times and seasons. Have a deep understanding of the times and seasons that we're living in, Jesus. I pray, God, that we would understanding of God, and move, God, not according to our own thought or our own way, but in all our ways acknowledge you, God, that you might direct our paths. Father, we surrender these things to you today. We pray for your wisdom. I pray this morning, God, for your wisdom and understanding and discernment. God, to understand what's going on around me, what's going on in me, what's going on through me, Jesus, that I would surrender my life completely and fully and wholly to you, God. Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for your grace, your mercy, all that you do for us. Help us, Lord, to leave this place a little bit more enlightened, a little bit deeper understanding, God, to just grow in you and to be everything you'd have us to be. And Father, we give you the praise for it. We give you the glory and the honor for it. And we ask it in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. You may be seated. So let me give you just a little bit of insight as to what is transpiring right now as to this season that we're in. Today, September the 13th, 2015, If you go a year back, September 28, 2014, it was the beginning of the Shemitah year, or the Shemitah year. Today is the ending of the Shemitah year. The Shemitah year is a year of Sabbath. It's a year that the Jews recognize and understand that it was a time to let the land rest, a rest for that year. God promised that if they would obey his command, obey his law, that in the sixth year there would be a double blessing. That blessing that would come in that sixth year as a result of their obedience for the seventh year would not only sustain them for the seventh year, but also for the eighth year and the ninth year. 3 years they would be sustained simply because of their obedience to the law of God. So here we are in the Shemitah year, and you probably heard a lot about the Shemitah year, of what's going on and what's taking place. And we understand that every 7 years it seems like some tragedy has happened in the nation of America. And I'm not here to be a prophet of doom to you today and tell you because of the result of this closing of this Shemitah year that something tragic is about to happen to America. I believe something's already tragic happened to America, and that's the fact that we've walked away from God. Amen. This country has walked away from God. Now, if you go back 7 years ago into 2008 at the close of the Shemitah year, we see that we've seen one of the most horrific falls of the stock market that this country's ever seen, one of the most biggest financial collapses that it's seen since the Great Depression. And we understand that that took place. If you go back 7 years before that, September 11, 2001, one of the greatest national tragedies that this country's ever seen. Nearly 3,000 people were killed as terrorists, 15 terrorists boarded planes and flew those planes in a different buildings across this country, and we saw one of the greatest national tragedies. So here we are again at the end of the seventh year, the Shemitah year, and we're getting ready to start into a new season. This season starts, if you will, tonight at sundown. The Jews begin to celebrate, the Jews begin to recognize what is called as Rosh Hashanah. It's a time of repentance. It's a time of they call it the 10 days of awe. And so here we are in this particular time of year. And then after the 10 days starts Yom Kippur. These are fall feasts that take place on the Jewish calendar. It's Yom Kippur. And then we go and we work up to the Day of Atonement or the Day of Celebration, which is the day the Feast of Tabernacles, which is the time that we tabernacle together with the Lord. There are a lot of theologians that are looking at this in a lot of different ways and talking about this as a time for a closing of this Sabbath year, and that it's time for us to go into a time of repentance. And as we go into that time of repentance and prayer and fasting through Yom Kippur, and then we go up to the time of tabernacle, that it very well could be that the Lord is coming to take us home. And I'm not trying to put days or times on that, but it is unique to me that when you study these things and see these things, that there's a lot of relevance that takes place with the church and with the Jewish calendar and with the feast and all these things. I understand and I know that the feast and all these things that took place in the Old Testament day were just pictures or symbols, if you will, of what was to come. God showed us through metaphors, if you will, or through symbolism of what was to come, especially through Christ. And I do not believe that God has stopped that cycle. The book of Ecclesiastes teaches us that those things which have been shall also be. There's nothing new under the sun. So these cycles, these processes that we go through, I believe that they are revealing to us as we begin to see the signs and the evidences of the things that are to come. Jesus said, when you see the leaves budding on the tree, that you know that summer is nigh. He said, "No, by this shall you also know that you shall not be in dark when, as the signs of the coming of the Son of Man are." He said that as it was in the days of Noah and as it was in the days of Lot, so shall it be in the coming of the days of the Son of Man. So we understand the times and seasons that we're in. I prayed just a moment ago that we would be like the sons of Issachar. The Bible said that the sons of Issachar had knowledge. They had understanding of the times that they lived in. We are living in some very perilous times. Paul warned Timothy in the last days that perilous times would come, that the love of many would wax cold. He talked about mothers turning against their daughters and fathers turning against their sons, and how this adversity would take place in the home, and how we'd see all these different collapses across humanity and morality. We're now seeing people without any inhibition whatsoever sitting on videos and talking about how they're taking baby parts from babies that have been aborted and selling them for profit. We're living in very dangerous, calloused, cold times. And you know, Bogart City Baptist has a sign up right now, and it says the problem with this country is not in the White House, it's in the church house. You know, it's not about the White House. It's not President Obama. It's not the Congress. It's not those guys. It's the fact that the people of God have not been what God has called them to be. We've got to get back to being what God has called us to be. We need to honor 2 Chronicles 7 and 14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, he said, then will I hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sin and I will heal their land. We need to get back to the place of God. We need to get back to a place of repentance. But we also need to get back to a place of understanding. The Bible teaches in Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10, I believe it is. The Bible said the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. We need to get knowledge. We need to get understanding. You're not going to find it sitting in front of a TV set. You're not going to find it sitting in the group of gossip. You're not going to find it. The place that you're going to find wisdom and understanding is when you begin to fear the Lord and have knowledge of the Holy One. That means you need to seek for Him. That means you need to go after Him. You see, we don't have to fall into the trap of secularism. We don't have to fall into the trap of humanism. We don't have to fall into the trap of popular opinion, because it's out there and it's in the church. I was talking with a gentleman yesterday, and he shared with me a pastor that is not too far from here. That pastor, it keeps beer in his refrigerator because it's become acceptable to drink like that. He's got himself all tattooed up. Matter of fact, had his church to pay for the tattoos that were on his arms, and it's okay. And they're preaching now that we got it wrong all these years, when we read scriptures like Romans chapter 1, where it talks about a man laying with a man and a woman laying with a woman, that we've got that thing wrong, that's really not applicable today, that it's okay, that God understands the homosexual movement. We've got preachers out there that are preaching and inverting the word of God, and Jesus warned us. He said, beware in that day, for there'll be many that come in my name, but they are false. They are deceiving. There is a deceiving spirit that's taking place. Well, I want you to know today that with everything that's within me, I've made up my mind that I'm going to stand on the book. I'm going to stand on the word of God, and I'm not going to bow away from it. Doesn't matter what popular opinion is. Doesn't matter what everybody else is saying. We got to have our mind made up that we're going to get the wisdom from God. We're going to have a fear of the Lord and believe what His book says. It doesn't matter what people say that doesn't apply anymore. It still applies. We're going to stand before Him one day, and we're going to be judged according to that book. We need wisdom. We need the fear of God back in the house of God again, so that the knowledge of the Holy One will give us understanding. We need this in this season. But you got to be a people that want to seek the Lord. God help me, Jesus. You can't be people. Listen, folks, when it's time to seek the face of God, we got to seek the face of God. When it's time to go after Him, we got to go after Him. And I believe there's ever been a season that we need to understand the time and the seasons that we're living in. It's now. It's now. It's a time to go after God. God, this wisdom, this fear of the Holy One, this knowledge of the Holy One. We understand, even the prophets of old understood this. Look what he says in Isaiah 11, 1 through 3. He said, there shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Verse 2, the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears. Listen, Jesus came not being blinded by what he saw, not being deafened by what he heard. He said, I'm going to stand firm on the counsel of the Lord. I'm going to walk in the fear of the Lord. We need to be those kind of people. We can't be blinded by what we see. See, there's a lot of things that are out there that are being saw or being put forth that we see, that if we're not careful, those things will cause us to become blind to the things that are spiritual. The Bible said, having ears, they hear not. Having eyes, they see not. It talks about a blinding that takes place in the last day. It talks about that we as people of God should walk by faith, not by sight. You can't go by what you see. He said, I'm not judged by the sight of my eyes, nor do I decide by the hearing of the ears. There's a lot of things that are being purported out there today. There are a lot of things that are being pushed forth. But the Bible said, whose report shall you believe? For me, I shall believe the report of the Lord. You got to have a made up mind that no matter what anybody else says, I'm going to stand on the word of God. It is true. It is eternal. It is faithful. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall never pass away. You got to stand on the word of God. Who is that Word? He's the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were created by Him, and there was not anything made that was made except it was made by Him. It was made for Him. The Bible said, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as the only begotten of the Father. I'm telling you, friend, He is the Word. You can stand in Jesus. You can rest in Jesus. You can abide in Jesus, and you can have all the stability that you need in this God-forsaken world. You need that wisdom. You need that understanding. It only comes through Jesus Christ. Prophet Jeremiah also saw this in Jeremiah chapter 23. He said, "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will raise to David a branch of righteousness. A king shall reign and prosper and execute judgment and righteousness in the earth. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will dwell safely. Now, this is his name by which he will be called." The Bible tells us that he's going to be called. Why? Because he's going to be called the Lamb of God. He's going to be the one that's the wisdom of God. He's going to be the strength of God. Paul said he's the power of God. It is Jesus. It only comes through Jesus. It's not going to come through a counselor. It's not going to come through a psychiatrist. It's not going to come through a doctor. It's not going to come through a boss man. Listen, my wife and I, we've been having some conversations, and this guy that I've been doing some work for has been promising more money for this, and if you work here, we're going to take care of you for this. And she said, she asked me yesterday, she said, "Honey, is there any of that coming?" I said, "I'm not holding my breath." You know why? Because you can't put your hope in man. You can't put your hope in what man's promised. You can't put, but God's promises are yes and amen. He will not fail. You can put your hope in that and know that Jesus Christ will come through exactly like He said He would. We need that kind of wisdom. We need that kind of understanding. In Proverbs 3, the Bible says, "Happy is the man who finds wisdom and the man who gains understanding." You want to be happy? Get wisdom. You want to be happy? Get wisdom. Gain understanding. Grow in knowledge. Walk in the fear of the Lord. Get in that place where you humble yourself before God and say, "God, I don't want to know anything except Jesus Christ, Him crucified in my life." Get in that place where you make up your mind that I'm not here to exalt myself in this world, but God, I've come to exalt You and You alone. Get in that place of happiness. Listen, we've got all kinds of remedies for happiness in the world today. We got people standing on street corners saying, "Hey, come lay with me, you'll be happy." We got people standing on street corners saying, "Hey, smoke this, you'll be happy." We got people saying, "Drink this, you'll be happy. Hey, take this pill, you'll be happy." But that's not happiness, friend. Happiness is not in getting a raise on the job. Happiness is not in getting a better job. Happiness is not in getting a better car. Listen to me. I found out something the other day. I found out that a brand new vehicle will still break down. Amen. I found out it still needs tires. I found out it still wears out. I found out that you're paying a monthly payment and you still got to put money into it. There's no happiness in stuff. Happiness is in the Lord. Happy is the man who finds wisdom. We're going to talk about that for just a moment. But look what he says in Proverbs 19:8. The Bible says that he who gets wisdom loves his own soul. He who keeps understanding will find good. So you get happy for finding wisdom. And when you get wisdom, it's a demonstration of loving your own soul. It's saying to God, "God, I'm concerned about my soul. I'm concerned that I don't die and go to hell. God, I want to know what's right. I want to know what's wrong. And I don't want to back down from right for nothing in this world. And I want to abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. God, so that I can find happiness in You." Listen, this is the beauty of the joy that the Lord gives. The joy of the Lord is our strength, right? So the Bible said that joy is our strength. And so, but God gives it to us. He gives us joy unspeakable and full of glory. Why, there's joy in that. He who gets wisdom loves his own soul. He who keeps understanding will find good. The writer of Proverbs continues on. Proverbs 24:13-14. He said, "My son, eat honey because it is good, and the honeycomb which is sweet to your taste. So shall the knowledge of wisdom be to your soul. If you have found it, there is a prospect, and your hope will not be cut off." Wisdom. It's like honey to the taste. Wisdom. It's wisdom to your soul. If you found it, there is a prospect, and your hope will not be cut off. You know why I got hope today? You know why I've got assurance today? You know why I have an understanding? You know why I feel good in my spirit today?
because I found the wisdom of God. I've sought him out. I've looked for him. And the Bible said when you seek for him with all your heart, you'll find him. There's great wisdom in a search for God, in a quest for the Lord. It's not to find out what the next statistics are of the ball game or what this person or what that person has done. I'd rather know Jesus than anything. Give me Jesus. Give me the power of the Spirit of God. Give me the outpouring of his presence. Give me Jesus. That's all I need. That's all I desire. That's all I'm looking for. I need the Lord.
Ecclesiastes 2:26, the Bible said, for God gives wisdom and knowledge and joy to a man who is good in his sight, but to the sinner he gives the work of gathering and collecting that he may give to him who is good before God. God gives wisdom. God gives knowledge. God gives joy to a man who is good in his sight. But to those that are sinners, those that have walked away from him, he takes away from them. He puts them on the work of gathering and collecting. Why? So that he can take it and give it to those that are good. Preacher, I don't know about that. Listen, that's what Jesus did. That he told the parable of the man with the talents, 5 talents, 2 talents, 1 talent to the guys. The 5 talents went and doubled his talents, got 10 talents. The guy with 2 talents went and doubled his talents. The guy with 1 talent, he buried his talent. When the master came back and said, "Why? What have you done with my talent?" The Bible said that he took that talent from him and gave it to one that had. Why? Because he's a wretched, wicked man. He didn't do what God, he didn't do what the master told him to do. Listen, folks, you're going to give an account before God one day. Listen, I don't want anybody taking my blessing. I don't want anybody taking my place. I don't want anybody standing in my place of my outpouring from God. I don't want to stand before God one day and say, you didn't do faithfully with what I gave you. You didn't weren't obedient to my call. You didn't live the way I told you to live. You just live for yourself. You live for the moment. You live for the time. And then stand before me and say, I'm going to take your blessing away, and I'm going to give it to Jim, or I'm giving it to Mike, or I'm going to give it to Bruce. I'm going to take your blessing. Listen, I don't want Jim, Mike, or Bruce having my blessing. I love them, but they got their own blessing. I want my blessing. I don't want God taking it away from me and giving it to somebody else. Amen. And we can take this a step further. The Bible said that you got an obligation, you got a commitment to live and praise and magnify God. Jesus said, if these hold their peace, the rocks will surely cry out. Listen, it is a commitment unto God. We got to have wisdom and understanding. I don't want anybody taking my place. I don't want no rock crying in my place. I don't want people stealing my blessing. I don't want things going on. No, I don't even want the devil getting it, not much less other people, because of my foolishness. I want to live wisely and do what God's called me to do so I can have the blessing of the Lord. We're living in dangerous times, folks. Paul says in the book of Colossians chapter 3, he said, let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Listen, this is what God's called us to do. God's called us to admonish one another. God's called us to strengthen one another. God's called us to encourage one another. God's called us to, listen, go back to verse 16. He says, sing to one another. We don't come together on Sunday morning. Kelsey and the team put together a worship program and a time of singing and rejoicing just so we can entertain. No, it's an encouragement. The word of Christ, I don't come to and prepare and put together a message just so, you know, we can say, hey, we did it. We showed up. It was church time. That's what we're supposed to do. No, it's a time to fill you with richness of wisdom of the word of God, that the word of God can change your life. You can teach and admonish one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. It ain't about you. It's about him. Amen. It should be about him. Shouldn't be about who showed up, who did this, who did that. It's all about him. In verse 17, he says, whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord. Do it in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. When you do it, don't do it for the benefit of somebody else seeing you. When you do it, don't do it for the benefit of trying to get. When you do it, don't do it for the benefit of somebody else wanting to pay a tribute to you. When you do it because you love the Lord and you give God thanks and praise and honor and glory to him. You got to do what you do as unto the Lord. I'm just going to slide this in here real quick, and I'm not saying this to be mean or anything, but I've had several people come to me and say, Pastor, you know, this box, this offering box, this other stuff that you're doing, these changes that you made, I don't know if I liked them too much. You know, I liked them when we did it the other way. You know, or I've even had people ask me, you know, about the offering. You know, there are people that are not giving now because you're not passing the offering plate. Let me tell you something. I believe if you've got a heart to give, you're going to give. Amen. I don't believe it. Listen, it doesn't matter if it's a box on a table or if it's an offering plate in your face or if it's an usher standing there begging you to give. Listen, if you've got a heart to give, you're going to give.
Amen. If you got a heart to worship, you're going to worship. Doesn't matter if the song is fast, the song is slow. Doesn't matter if the people are in the building or not. Listen, I've been in here and worshiped God with nobody here, with no lights on, with no cameras running. Just come in here and worship the Lord because He's worthy. But listen, whatever's in your heart, you do it as unto the Lord. I'm not doing it for your benefit. I'm not doing it to make you feel good. I'm not doing it to get an impression by you. No, friend, I do it as unto the Lord. I praise the name of the Lord because God has brought me from a dark place and put me in light. And I'm telling is worthy of praise and glory and honor. I was bound, I was afflicted, I was chained, but God set me free. And what I do is unto the Lord. If I give, I give unto the Lord. If I praise, I praise unto the Lord. If I shout, I shout unto the Lord. It is not about you or anybody else. It's all about Jesus. It is He that has made us, not we ourselves. He's the one that caught us out of darkness into His marvelous light. Woo! Glory to God. He's worthy of praise. He's worthy of praise. He's worthy of praise. Whew. Glory to God. Glory to God. In Matthew chapter 6, there's a lot of when you's. When you pray. When you fast. When you give. You know, when Jesus is teaching in Matthew chapter 6, the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus is teaching, He's teaching, listen, this is something that you're going to do. If you're going to be a part of me, this is what you're going to do. When you pray, you're going to pray. Listen. Either you pray because you want to pray, or you're going to pray because you're forced to pray. Let me say that again. You either go pray when you want to pray, or you're going to be forced to pray. That means when you don't want to pray, circumstance is going to come your way that's going to force you to pray. God will have interaction with His people one way or another. The Israelites, they're a perfect example. They went about carelessly doing what they wanted to do, living like they wanted to live, acting like they wanted to act, and all of a sudden God sent them into bondage. What did it do? It forced them to call upon the name of the Lord. And when they called on the name of the Lord, the Bible said that God heard them and delivered them. Listen, God will put you in a position that you will communicate to Him. I would much rather do it from the position of strength than from the position of weakness. I would much rather do it from the position of saying, God, You're just good to me, and I just want to talk to You, rather than, oh, God, You got to get me out of this mess. You see, when you get in the mess and you've had that constant communication with the Lord, you won't fret, you won't get anxious, you won't get worried, because you know the Lord's got it. So here we go. Let's see what we got to do. So how do we get this wisdom? I want to give you 5 biblical instructions on how to get wisdom. Proverbs 4 and 8. Let's look at this scripture. The Bible says, exalt her and she will promote you. Now, we're talking about wisdom here. She will bring you honor when you embrace her. You got to desire wisdom with all your might. There has to be a desire inside of it. Listen, when you embrace something, when you exalt something, when you promote something, listen, you're giving recognition to it. You know? I was picking with Tracy the other day. We were talking about going somewhere, and I told her, I said, come on, I want to take you out and show you off. You know, I like to show off. She's my wife. I like to show off. I like the world to see the blessings of God. For an old scrub like me can get somebody that looks as good as her. Come on now. I want people to see. Look at this, boy. Woo, she's mine. Jerry Gunn gave her to me. Glory to God. She's mine. I want people to see her. She's funny about how she goes outside. Amen. Because, see, it all boils down to exalting, to promoting. Listen, when you exalt wisdom, when you promote wisdom, they're going to bring you honor. They're going to embrace. Listen, you embrace her. Listen, embracing. Listen what it says. To prize something and embrace someone are signs of intense desire and love. Wisdom should be valuable to us. It should be something that you seek after. It's something I ask God for daily. Lord, give me wisdom. Give me understanding. God, give me discernment. Those are 3 things I ask for daily. God, give me these things, Lord. I need these things. I can't make it without these things. I got to have Your wisdom. I got to have Your understanding, God. I got to have discernment. We're living in a day and time where you need discernment. Because there are things that look flashy. They look spiritual. They look hyped up. They look boring. And it'd be very easy to get swayed by those things. But discernment will tell you if it's true or not. Everything that flashes ain't gold. Sometimes it's brass. The Bible says to seek it. Seek it like silver. Search for it as a hidden treasure. Proverbs 2 and 4. I don't know if I had that one up there or not. He said, but we must be willing to sell all in order to buy it. If you seek or silver, search for it as hidden treasures. Jesus said, it's like the kingdom of heaven is like a man who went and found a pearl of great price, and he hid it in the field, and he went and sold everything he had just to buy the field. And it wasn't even about the field. It was about the pearl that was hid in the field. Listen, friend, you got to be willing to sell out all. You got to be willing to lay it all down. Well, preacher, I can't give this up. Well, you ain't all in. Well, preacher, I can't walk away from this. Well, you ain't all in. Listen, you gotta have a made-up mind that says, you know what, I don't care what it costs me. I don't care what I got to lay down. I don't care what I got to walk away from. If I can just have him, it'll be worth everything. I got to have the Lord. The Lord's got to be on my side. If it's not for the Lord who's on my side, I surely would have perished. But because God is on my side, because God is for me, nothing shall be against me. Listen, folks, God's got a plan. God's got a plan. You got to be hungry for wisdom. Then when you enter in this building today, I pray God to make you more hungry. For when you're hungry for that, you'll be satisfied. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. I believe you can substitute wisdom there. If you're hungry and thirsty for wisdom, you can be filled with wisdom. Amen. Secondly, number two, since wisdom is found in the Word of God, we must apply ourselves and study meditation to know the Word and do it. Psalm 19:7. The Bible says in Psalm 19:7, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. You want wisdom? You'll find it in the Word of God. Amen. You got to seek the Scriptures. You got to study to show yourself approved. You got to know a workman rightly dividing the Word of truth needed not to be ashamed. We must devote ourselves to know and understand the testimonies of the Lord. Listen, it gives me assurance when I know, number one, that God is no respecter of persons. And so if God's no respecter of persons, what I read in that Bible that he did for others, I know that it's available to me. Amen. If God got Daniel through the lion's den, God will get me through a lion's den. I might not have to go to a physical lion's den, but sometimes I walk through spiritual lion's dens. And I can still have the confidence. I can rest in assurance to know that God will take those lions and make them mattresses and pillows for me and help me to rest in him. If God get the Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego through the fiery furnace, surely God will get me through my fiery furnaces. I know that God is no respecter of person. If God brought David through the attack of the bear and the attack of the lion, I know that God can take me through. If God gave David the ability to stand before a Goliath and knock him down by the power of God, then I know that God will see me through. There is a testimony of the Lord that if we'll just abide in those testimonies and see the Word of the Lord, it'll get you through. You want wisdom? It's going to be in the wisdom of God's Word. In God's Word, you got to know the testimonies, Lord. So I commend not only faithful Bible study, but also regular reading of great books on theology and biblical interpretation, books that distill the wisdom of the greatest students of the Word over the past 1,900 years. Listen, you can find great wisdom if you'll study. Listen to this. I got this from Pastor John Piper. Maybe some of you here are saying, well, I just don't have time to read. I got this from Pastor John Piper. Let me break this down for you real quickly. I want to show you something really encouraging. When John Piper, I read this, I'm telling you, it impacted me. Number one, this. We don't aspire very high in our reading because we don't feel like there's any hope. But listen to this. Suppose you read 250 words a minute. 250 words a minute. That's not a lot. But suppose you read 250 words a minute. Now think about this. And then you just decide, I'm going to read 15 minutes a day. Now everybody can carve out 15 minutes. If you just take some of your dead time or some of your TV time, you can carve out 15 minutes. Suppose you read 15 minutes a day. To serious theological reading, to deepen your grasp of biblical truth. In 1 year, 365 days, you would read 5,475 minutes. Now, 5,475 minutes, multiply that 250 words per minute, and you're going to get 1,368,750 words a year that you can read if you just devote 15 minutes a day to reading. Now, most books have between 300 and 400 words per page. So if we take 350 words per page and divide that into 1,368,750 words per year, we get 3,910 pages per year. That means at 250 words a minute, 15 minutes a day, you could read about an average of 20 average-sized books a year. Just spending 15 minutes a day reading, you could read 20 books a year. 20 books. Think about that for a moment. John Piper said when he heard that, he went home and he looked at what was going on. And he set aside 15 minutes a day. And he began to find out that books just began to, he began to put one book back on the shelf and pick another book up. Listen, you can get wisdom if you want wisdom. You just have to designate your time. You have to properly acknowledge what kind of day you got going on. And listen, there is nothing greater than sitting down, and if nothing else, get your Bible out and read 15 minutes a day. It will change your life. But I don't want to forget, the Bible said that there's safety in a multitude of counselors. So there's some great people out there that have wrote some great commentaries and great subjects on great subjects on biblical knowledge that we can learn from. If you want wisdom, go get wisdom. And the Bible said when you get wisdom, you'll be happy. So what is this all about? So when you get this, it might be that before long, somebody might say of you in Proverbs 18:4, somebody might come to you and say, the words of a man's mouth are deep waters. The wellspring of wisdom is a flowing brook. Wouldn't it be awesome to have such wisdom, such knowledge that people seek you out for instruction? Every one of you have the capability to do that, from the youngest to the oldest. Well, preacher, I can't read too good. Give what you got. Give what you got, and God will make you better. When you give it to the Lord, you put it in His hands, I'm telling you, God will make you better. Well, preacher, I didn't come to church this morning to get lectured about reading. Well, listen, you want to be better? You got to put forth yourself. The Bible said you study to show yourself approved. You got to put forth the effort. You got to be what God's called you to be and align your life with that. Oh, let me get off that. Number three, to get wisdom, you got to pray. Got to pray. Solomon was not born a wise man. He prayed for wisdom. Prayed for wisdom. God said to him in 1 Kings chapter 3, let's look what it says. Solomon said, you have shown great mercy to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in truth, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart with you. You have continued this great kindness for him, and you have given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day. Now, O Lord God, my king, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king instead of my father David. But I am a little child. I know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to be numbered or counted. Therefore, give to your servant an understanding heart to judge your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of yours? The speech pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. Then God said to him, because you have asked this thing and have not asked for long life for yourself, nor have asked riches for yourself, nor have asked the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern justice. Behold, I have done according to your words. See, I have given you a wise and understanding heart, so that there has not been anyone like you before you, nor shall any like you arise after you. And I have also given you what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that there shall not be anyone like you among the kings of all your days. So if you walk in my ways to keep my statutes and my commandments, as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your days. Look, this is the beauty of it. When you seek wisdom, you get what you didn't even ask for. Why? Because then you have an understanding how to handle what problems come your way. Listen, Tracy and I have been in the midst of some decision making that we've had to make over the last couple of weeks, and we're trying to decide which direction God. And listen, one thing I'm not asking God to give me what I'm wanting. I'm asking God to give me wisdom. Need wisdom, need understanding. God, I don't need you just to hand this in my lap, ladies. God, give me wisdom. Give me understanding as to what I need to do and what direction I need to go. Lord, I need some wisdom from you. And Solomon asked of God, said, God, give me wisdom. Give me understanding. And the Bible said that he became one of the wisest kings to ever sit on the throne of Israel. But not only that, but he was one of the blessed kings because he didn't ask selfishly. Preacher, you know, you put that out there, and there might be people out there that will say, well, I'm just going to ask for wisdom and in hopes of getting the other stuff. Well, you done shot yourself in the foot already. You ask for wisdom because you need wisdom. You ask for understanding because you need understanding. And when you get wisdom and understanding, there might be some wisdom and understanding that you don't need what you thought you needed. Amen. You might not need to win the lottery. You might find that out later. You might feel like you need it now, but you might not need it. It's wisdom. It's understanding. Get it. How do you get it? You pray for it. Daniel admitted that he had no wisdom. In Daniel 2:30, the Bible says, but as for me, this secret has not been revealed to me because I have more wisdom than anyone living. Daniel said, I don't have the wisdom I need. Daniel prayed for it. But in Daniel 2:23, he prays. He said, Lord, I thank you and I praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and might and have now made known to me what we ask of you. Daniel said, God, you gave me this wisdom because I prayed for it. We've seen how Paul prayed that the churches might be given spiritual wisdom in Colossians 1 and 9. We see where it says, for this reason we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding. We ask for those things. He said in Ephesians 1 and 17, the Bible said that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. And finally, James puts it as clearly as you wish. He says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. When you pray and you seek the face of God and you dig in his word, you can get the wisdom of God, and it will make all the difference for you. The wisdom that leads to true and lasting happiness is not natural or inborn. It is supernatural. It is the gift of God. Therefore, if we would get wisdom, we've got to pray. Number four, the fourth biblical instruction for how to get wisdom is to think frequently of your death. Oh, preacher, I don't want to think about that. You better remember that you don't have many days left. I promise you, today you are one day less than you were yesterday. Amen. Let's just put it in simple terms. We're all dying in this world. Amen. This body is anyway. Every day I'm one day closer. Not just to the grave, but to glory. Amen. But while I'm in this world, I need to be cognizant of the fact that I am dying, that my days are few. Put it another way, think of the shortness of this life and the infinite length of the next. Psalm 90 and 12, David says, so teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. You know, I was sharing with somebody this week. I sat down and talked with them, and they were talking about my schedule and the things that goes on and how you, and I told them, I said, look, I looked at them, I said, I know I'm only 42 years of age, but I don't know how much longer I can keep up this pace. I realize I'm just one man. You're just one person. There's only so much you can do in life. But this is the thing that I have determined. I don't want to look back with regret. I don't want to look back with regret. I don't want to look back and say, I wish I could have, should have, would have. I want to live my life with great wisdom and say, God, I want to be the best I can be for this day. So when tomorrow comes and I look back at the day, I can say to you, God, I did my best. I put forth my best effort. And God, I'm going to put forth a better effort today. Listen, you got to understand, you got to number your days. You got to teach you to number your days that you can gain a heart of wisdom. I realized real quick, I am not 20 years old anymore. And there are times I try to do things that I used to could do at 20. And I realized real quick, I'm not 20 years old anymore. I was at Brother Scott's house one day. He was over there, and he had a broken water line. And he wanted to scoot under the house with me. And there, you know, Brother Scott, you're just a few years older than me. Am I right? Just a few? A few. Okay, that's good. Well, you know, at the time, I was about 41, I guess. It's just been about a year ago. And I got up under the house, and I was trained to go up under houses. And so I was scooting across through under that house. And Brother Scott looked up, and he said, I was already across the house over there. He said, I imagine when I get to 47, I'm going, trying to crawl under a house if I got to crawl under a house. But there are times I sat down yesterday, or no, we were over at Bud Terry's house, and my wife asked me, said, come over, help me over here with these muscadines. So I went over there, I was helping to pick, and I went to reach up one time, and went, oh, I never felt that before. That 42-year-old body said, oh, you know, something began to happen to a man when you hit 40. I don't know what it is. Any man over 40 here know what I'm talking about? Something began to happen. Things don't move and bend the way they used to. Amen. And if you sit long enough, it gets stiff. Wait, I get what? God, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. 60. Lord, help me, Jesus. Get me out of here. Woo. I'm like Dr. Voice. If this ain't the last days, Lord, come on and deliver us now. God, help me. Teach you to number your days. Understand that you ain't got, listen, you only got your life to live. We don't know what tomorrow holds. James said life is but a vapor. Is there one moment, go on the next. You got to number your day. You got to understand, man, I don't get second chances in this thing. I don't get do-overs in life. Whatever I've done is done, and I got to move on. Teach you to number your days. Teach you to understand and get wisdom. Because if you come, get ready. There is scarcely any thought that will purge our priorities of vain and worldly perceptions like the thought of our imminent death. You know, I've stood at the bedside of a lot of people that were fighting for the last breath. And I never once heard anybody say, I wish I could get up from here and go get a better paying job. Never once heard anybody say, I wish I could go fill out that application. I wish I could go get that car. I wish I could get that house. Never once heard that. But most people that could talk to me, they lay there on their deathbed. So I wish I'd love my family better. I wish I'd have spent more time with my kids. I wish I'd have loved my wife better. I wish I'd love my husband better. They were full of regret because they wished they would have. And I'll tell you something, friends. That puts a determination inside of me, and it should put a determination inside of you not to get to that point of a deathbed and look back and say, man, I wish I would have. I wish I'd have done more for the kingdom. I wish I'd have done more for Jesus. I wish I'd have done more to tell people about him. It's worth telling the story. You don't have every day. You don't have, listen, I've had people tell me, preacher, I'll get right one day. I got the rest of my life. You don't know how long the rest of your life is. I've got two cousins in the grave. One died when he was 18 and the other one died when he was 21. Both of them killed in tragic car accidents. Both of them 4 days prior to their death. One, my brother invited one cousin to church and he said, I ain't got time for that. I got the rest of my life. I'll get right some other day. 4 days later, he flipped up a guide wire and flipped his truck and it killed him instantly. My other cousin was, his mom was trying to get him to go to church, and as he was going out the door, he cussed his mama. Went out and got drunk and flipped his car and killed instantly. Now, I don't know what happened in those 4 days. I don't know what transpired. I'm not here to judge anybody, but I'm going to tell you this. We shouldn't live with regret. We don't know that we got tomorrow. We don't know what we got any other day. We don't know what's going on in that moment of time. But you better number your days that you can gain wisdom. And say to God, God, I can't live for myself today, God. I gotta live for you. The fifth and final one. The absolutely essential thing to you to do to get wisdom is you gotta come to Jesus. He's the wisdom from God. If you don't know him, you don't have wisdom. If I had time, I'd read you back through the text. He said he took the wisdom of the world and he brought it to naught. The prudent and the understanding, he just decimated it with his wisdom, with his understanding. The only true wisdom that you're going to get is going to be found in Jesus Christ. The only true power that you're going to be found is going to be in Jesus Christ. It is the only place. Verse 24, 1 Corinthians 1 and 18. Oh, 1 Corinthians 1 and 24. Tracy, if you can find that one for me. It tells us, listen, he tells us that Jesus is the wisdom from God. Let me back up for just a minute. Look at these. Go back for you to Matthew. Matthew chapter 12. Jesus himself says this. In Matthew chapter 12, Trace, I got it up there, 12:42, I believe it is. He said, the queen of the south will rise up in judgment with this generation and condemn it, for she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. And indeed, a greater than Solomon is here. Jesus speaking of himself. Solomon was wise. He said, but I'm greater than Solomon. I'm greater than Solomon. Listen, if you're going to find real wisdom, you're going to find it in Jesus Christ. It's only in him. When you get in Christ and you get in Christ alone, you have everything you need. All the wisdom, the peace, the healing, the power, the strength, the understanding. All that's going to come in Jesus Christ. What an understatement. Greater than Solomon indeed. Solomon spoke God's wisdom. Jesus is the wisdom of God. Look again, 1 Corinthians 1, 24. Both to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Verse 30. But of him who are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God. He is our wisdom. It is all in him. Others have spoken truth, but he is the truth. He didn't just speak truth. He was truth. Others have pointed the way of life, but he is the way. He is the life. John 14 and 6. Jesus said, I'm the way. I'm the truth. I'm the life. He didn't say, I'm coming to speak to you of the way. I'm not coming to speak to you of truth. I'm not coming to speak to you about life. I am the way. I am the truth. And I am the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. You want wisdom? You got to come to Jesus. You got to come to Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Others had spoken truth. Others had given promises. But the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 1 and 20 that all the promises of God find their yes in him. All of them are yes. All his promises, they're yes. And in him, amen, to the glory of God through us. Others had offered God's forgiveness. Jesus bought it by his death. Therefore, in him, the Bible says in Colossians 2 and 3, to the knowledge of the mystery of God, both of the Father and of Christ. Keep going. In whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. It's all in him. It's all in Christ. You want peace, you want joy, you want strength, you want healing, you want wisdom, it's in Him. You're not going to find it in this preacher. You're not going to find it in this friend. You're not going to find it in this mate. You're not going to find it with this child. You're not going to find it in this job. It's in Him. It's all in Him. Everything about Him is wisdom and strength and life and truth and the glory of God. To know and love and follow Jesus is to own the treasure of ultimate and eternal happiness. Therefore, the command, get wisdom, means first and foremost, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom. If you, at this moment, are not confronted with a situation where you need the wisdom from God, you will be. You will be. Job said it, that the days of men are few and full of trouble. You're going to need the wisdom from God. There are some of you right now, you're in the midst of valleys like you've never seen before. You need the wisdom from God. There's some of you right now, you're fighting through turmoil in your home. You're fighting through turmoil in your job. You're fighting in turmoil in your marriage. You're fighting turmoil with a friendship. You're fighting in turmoil with something, financial, whatever it is. You need the wisdom from God. Some of the biggest failures in my life, Pastor Roger, some of the biggest failures in my life is when I got a jam, I tried to figure it out for myself. And I made a worse jam of it. And if I just stopped and said, God, what are you teaching me in this? What do you want me to learn from this? Lord, let me learn to be content within the state I'm in. Let me learn, God, that I need to be content in you. And if you give, then blessed be the name of the Lord. And if you take away, blessed be the name of the Lord. But we get stressed, we get worried, we get overwhelmed because we're just looking for more to satisfy our identity. But all you need is Him. All you need is Him. I don't need anything else more than that. I just need Him. Because when I got Him, I got everything I need. So I'm going to make this altar call very simple this morning. And let me just remind you tonight we're going to come together and I'm going to be presenting tonight, okay? So ladies and men, you're going to stay with me tonight. Because we got some things that we need to seek wisdom for. We got some things we need to talk about. We're going to talk about it. As it relates to us personally, as it relates to us as a ministry, as a church, we got some things we need some wisdom from God on. But for this moment right now, I want to talk to you about individual situations, not as us corporately. We'll talk about the corporate wisdom we need tonight. But as individuals, there are people in this building right now, you are facing adversity. You are between a rock and a hard place, and you don't know which way to turn. And you need wisdom from God. In just a moment, I'm going to ask you to come to this altar and lay it before Him. There are some of you right now, life is scary good for you. Life is scary good. It seems like everything's clicking and everything's going in order. I promise you, this world's not going to allow that to continue to happen. If this world gets the opportunity, at the first opportunity, it's going to kick you in the teeth. And the devil's going to pull the rug out from under you that you think's your little magic carpet that's taking you from one point A to point B. He's going to snatch it out from under you and cause you to collapse. I'm telling you. Jesus promised us in this world we would have trials and tribulations. But fear not, for I've overcome the world. He didn't say everything was going to be hunky-dory and you're just going to walk through this world and not have any problems. But He said, I'll get you through this mess if you'll just trust in me. So I'm inviting everybody that will. Whether you're in a situation now or through the preaching of this message, you're in realization that a situation could very well be coming. Remember, it is God's calendar. And for the last so many years, something's happened. And I believe God's got to give us wisdom as individuals, and God's going to give us wisdom as a body, that we can do what God's called us to do and be understanding of the times and seasons that we're in. So as we close today in prayer, I'm asking everybody that will, to come and say, God, grant me three things: wisdom, understanding, and discernment. For my present situation or for my situations to come, God, I want to go ahead and begin this journey right now. And I want to get wisdom from you. He is the power and the wisdom from God. Would you come? Would you come and find a place of prayer? Would you intercede and ask God, please give me wisdom? Give me insight to what I need to do, God, what difference I need to make.
Listen, if it's a home problem, bind together with your husband and your wife and say, God, give us wisdom. Give us understanding. Give us insight, God. If it's a job situation, whatever it is, give it to God. Say, Lord, give me wisdom. Grant me great understanding, oh God, to do what you call me to do. To live my life, God, to be acceptable in your sight, I pray in the name of Jesus. Speak to us today, God. Speak to us today, Jesus. Speak to us today, Jesus. Speak to us today, Jesus. God, we want to be in you and you alone. God, we want to be in you and you alone.
Give me vision.
Give us vision, God.
To see things like you do.
Lord, I want to see it just like you see it.
Where my help comes.
Don't let me be blind to Jesus.
Give me wisdom.
Don't let me be blind to Jesus.
You know just what to do, which is strong, and the foolish things to shame the wise. So God, I look to you, and I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do, yeah.
The sovereignty of God is one of the hardest things to trust, because we're not sovereign. We're not omniscient. But it's hard to trust the sovereignty of God. But God knows what he's doing. And he's working all things for our good. He's working all things for our good. Preacher, I don't understand why I'm going through this. Sometimes it might not be for us to understand. It might be just for us to trust that he knows what he's doing. I don't see the end of it, preacher. It doesn't matter. He's already called the end from the beginning. So just trust him. I don't know how I'm going to make it through this. Then just cast your cares on him, because he cares for you. Don't worry about tomorrow. He's got tomorrow. Live while it's yet day, for dark coming when no man can work. Do what you got to do today. Don't fret over tomorrow. Matter of fact, it's sin to be anxious. The Bible says, be anxious for nothing. It's sin to be anxious. God, give me great wisdom so that I don't fret about tomorrow. I don't worry about the next day, God. I just trust you to know that these reports are not final, but what you say, God, is final. He's a good God, amen? He's in control, amen? As Jason Crabb sings, he knows what he's doing, amen? He knows what he's doing. God's in control. God's in control. And listen, the same God that said, let it be, is the same God that's looking out for your life. If you ever have doubts, just go outside and look up at the sun and say, my Father, the same one that said, let it be, is the same one that's looking over my life. At night, go out and look at the stars and see if you can count them or number them, but God knows every one of them by name. And say, my Father that looked out over those is the same God that's taking care of me. Go outside this fall day when everything starts to brown up and it looks like winter's coming. It looks like the birds and the animals aren't going to have enough to sustain themselves. And remember that God's concerned that even a little sparrow. Look at the lily of the field, how they're clothed. Not Solomon in all his glory is arrayed like one of these, but yet God looks out for us. That's great wisdom today. That's the promises. That's assuring yourself of the Lord's testimonies. God said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. I'm going to go with you even to the end of the earth. I'm with you. So that means if you're up, he's with you. If you're down, he's with you. Doesn't matter where you're at, no matter what you're going through, he's with you. There's great wisdom in that. Ain't my word, it's his. His promises. And that one last scripture says his promises are yes. That means if he's going to do it, if it's to be done, if he said it, it's going to happen. Might not happen on your calendar. Might not happen according to your watch. But God's got it. Trust Him. Trust the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. For in all your ways, acknowledge Him. He will direct your paths. Amen. Trust Him. He's got it. He's got that kidney, Terry. Whether He's going to heal yours or send you another, He's got it. He's got it. Amen. I don't know what listen, I could go around this room all day long and talk about situations, circumstances, but God's got it. Let me correct it. He's got it if you let Him have it. If you hang on to it, He's going to let you have it. And then you've had it. Amen. But if you let Him have it, it's good as done. Amen. Man, I tell you, I feel this thing. Listen, I pray you come back this evening. And we're just looking forward to what the Lord has to speak to us. It's going to be a semi-sharing message, meeting, something. I don't know what's going to come out of it. Doris says she's been praying. I start preaching again on Sunday night. Doris, I'm going to give it about 15 minutes worth tonight, all right? All right. Kathy said, thank you. I'm gonna give it what God tells me to give it, all right? In my mind's one thing, but in the heart of God, it might be different. But tonight, I want to share, and those of you that do youth class, if y'all want to stay in here, that's fine. Maybe people need to hear this. But if you can, y'all still have children's church for me. Amen. All right. Take care of the kids. So tonight will be a little bit different than what we've been doing. But I believe the Lord laid on my heart that it's time for me to talk to you about some things, share some things with you. And we're going to see what God has for us moving forward. Because I believe that's what we're doing, moving forward. Amen. But it's going to take some great wisdom, great understanding, great insight from God to do what we need to do. Because these things are bigger than us, but they're not bigger than Him. Amen. He's a good God. Let's stand and we're going to be dismissed. Appreciate you being in the house of the Lord. Just thank God for what He's doing. Just believe and trust for the Lord's will be done. Brother Joel, would you dismiss the prayer, brother?